Well, let's look to the Lord in prayer as we begin our time together. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for your goodness to us, and we thank you for the privilege we have to be called the people of God. We thank you for the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross to make it possible for us to have a relationship with you. And Lord, we cherish and appreciate all that you've done for us and will continue to do for us until, as we have sung, our task on earth is done. Lord, I praise you that you are a faithful God. Faithful is he who has begun a good work in us, and you will be faithful to complete that good work in each of our lives. To the praise of your glory, and for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord, in whose precious and powerful name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Well, the story is told of a lady called Helene Madison. She was a 1932 Olympic champion. Royal Broome of the Seattle Post-Intelligencer wrote, she could outswim any woman on earth, just like Katie Ledecky, just who won several medals at the Rio Olympics. But after winning 23 national championships and breaking every world record, she dropped from sight. 30 years later, Broome wrote a different story. He told of finding Helene sitting in a one-room basement apartment, a despondent woman, forgotten by the world and desperately ill. The former champion was planning to drive her car to some dead-end road, close the windows, and by piping in carbon monoxide, snuff out the life that still remained in her cancer-ravaged body. Broome convinced her to change her mind and seek help. A year later, she died, but not without hope. In recounting her death, Broome wrote, at long last, Helene Madison placed her thin, frail hand into the hand of a bedside counselor and asked the Lord Jesus to come into her heart. She found the peace she had unsuccessfully sought in so many byways. Well, the Assyrian Empire was the champion and conqueror of the nations in the days of the prophet Nahum. They captured and conquered nations. They plundered and pillaged kingdoms. They were cruel and committed unbelievable atrocities. They broke every world record of wickedness and wretchedness in their day. But they too, like Helene Madison, will become despondent and dejected as Yahweh moves in to unleash his righteous judgment on them. Yahweh will hold them accountable and pay them in kind for their wickedness and wretchedness. However, unlike Helene Madison, who found hope and peace in Jesus Christ in her dying hours, the people of Assyria will perish in the righteous judgment of God without hope and without finding lasting peace. They will face God not as their savior, but as their judge. They will learn in death that Yahweh will right all the wrongs of history. You see, the unprecedented cruelty of the Assyrians was the reason for their fall under the stroke of God's judgment. So this brings me to the main idea of the message God has given me from his word to deliver to you. Actually, the last message in chapter 2 of Nahum, which God has given me to deliver to you at this decisive hour in your life and my life. So please, I want you to pay close attention to it, not just with your head, but more importantly with your heart, where the Holy Spirit is ready and resolved to plant the seed of God's eternal and enduring truth in order to transform genuine born-again believers among us here today, more into the blessed likeness of Jesus Christ, who is the rock and refuge of the church, and to turn unbelievers from their sin of unbelief, gently and graciously leading them to genuine repentance and personal saving faith in Jesus Christ, who is the rescuer and redeemer of sinners. So here is our message in a nutshell. Please, I urge you once again to pay very close attention to it with an open heart and an open mind, willing to receive it and respond to it. So here is the message in this sentence. At his appointed time, listen carefully, Yahweh will assuredly and justly punish a godless and guilty nation for the crimes and cruelty committed in search of her own prophet. Let me repeat, at his appointed time, Yahweh will assuredly and justly punish a godless and guilty nation for the crimes and cruelty committed in search of her own prophet. To put it simply, Yahweh's judgment may not be immediate, but it is inevitable. Folks, friends, faithful followers of Christ among us here today, and fellow believers in the fold and flock, fellowship and family of God, the Bible is going to faithfully and freshly reveal to us today that Yahweh, that is God Almighty, righteously judges a guilty, a godless, and a greedy nation in his own time and way, paying them in kind and in full. For Nineveh, which we have been studying, that time will come in 612 BC. Figuratively, the Bible will portray for us the defeat, the devastation, the destruction of Nineveh because of her lust for conquest, her greed, and her godlessness. Figuratively depicted as a lion, Nineveh has engaged in search for prey. Now, however, she's herself the object of such search, and herself becomes a prey. So this is what we are about to see for ourselves in our study. So please, if you have your Bibles, turn them to Nahum chapter 2, verse 10 to 13. Would you please listen carefully as I recite our passage of study from the updated New American Standard Bible, which is the most literal translation of our Bible into our English language. The Bible says, I'll start from verse 10. Last week I recited the whole of chapter 2 because I know I won't have time to do it today. So the Bible begins in chapter 2, verse 10 of Nahum. She is emptied. Yes, she is desolate and waste. Hearts are melting and knees knocking. Also, anguish is in the whole body, and all their faces are grown pale. Where is the den of the lions and the feeding place of the young lions, where the lion, lioness, and lion's cub prowled with nothing to disturb them? The lion tore enough for his cubs, killed enough for his lionesses, and filled his lairs with prey and his dens with torn flesh. Behold, I am against you, declares the Lord of hosts. I will burn up her chariots in smoke. A sword will devour your young lions. I will cut off your prey from the land, and no longer will the voice of your messengers be heard. This is the word of God to the people of God, and may the Lord add his blessing to the recital of his holy word. We have before us a passage of scripture that can be accurately described as a passage of desolation on one hand and declaration on the other hand. First of all, it is a passage of desolation because it visually depicts the desolation of Nineveh. I tell you, friends, Yahweh's righteous judgment of Nineveh will not only result in the defeat and the destruction of Nineveh, but also its desolation. This is what the Bible is going to show us. In fact, that is why our passage begins with the desolation of Nineveh. That is why it says, she's emptied. Yes, she's desolate. Giving us that picture right away. Well, second, it is a passage of declaration because it vividly devotes its final words on the declaration of Yahweh against Nineveh. Speaking definitively and directly to Nineveh, Yahweh Sabaoth himself makes one of the most dreadful declarations the people of Nineveh ever had in their lives. And what is that declaration? Yahweh declares, I am against you. And that is why our passage will end with the declaration of the Lord of hosts. So these are the reasons why our passage of study is a passage that can be accurately described on one hand as desolation, because it will speak to us about desolation and then also about declaration. It begins with desolation and ends with the declaration of Yahweh. So having simply whetted your spiritual appetite, would you please allow me now to give you a brief overview of how the Holy Spirit has prepared me to present this message to you from start to finish. First of all, the Holy Spirit will emphasize to us that the desolation of Nineveh is prophesied. We'll see that in the first part of verse 10. The once influential, wealthy city of Nineveh is now prophetically painted as left desolate, plundered, and completely destroyed. Yahweh's righteous judgment of a guilty and godless nation may not be immediate, but please make no mistake about this. It is inevitable. Nineveh learned this lesson the bitter way, the hard way, and it is recorded for us also to learn from. Well, second, the despondency of the Ninevites is pictured for us in verse 10b. You see, courage has fled the Ninevites, and none of them has the heart to continue the struggle and striving for the defense of the city. Remember, they were trying, doing everything to defend their city. But at last, they didn't have the heart to continue that struggle. With despair, hopelessness, sadness, and terror, they view the ruin of their once magnificent and mighty city. And I tell you, folks, theirs was a despondency of epic proportions. Now the third, the devastation of Nineveh is portrayed for us in verses 11 to 12. In these verses, the prophet Nahum ironically contrasts the devastated and desolate city of Nineveh with its former glory and power, expressed in figurative terms. The question is, what do we do the figures of the lion? Remember, he uses the lion, the lioness, the cubs, the lion's cub, the lion's den. What are these figures referring to? Well, with the help of the Holy Spirit and the Holy Scriptures, we will answer those questions in a moment. Fourth and finally, the declaration of Yahweh against Nineveh is presented to us in verse 13. Please listen carefully. The destruction of Nineveh will assuredly take place. Why? Because Yahweh himself has declared it. If God didn't declare it, it will never happen. But God says, this is what I'm doing, and that is what he will do. And he will fulfill his word. The Lord of hosts has declared to the people of Nineveh these dreadful words. I am against you. And I tell you, folks, I am against you should be the most feared words a nation could receive from Yahweh. That is the self-existing, the self-sufficient, the sovereign and supreme deity of the universe. And I hope that those words, I am against you, is not spoken against the United States of America. Because if that those words are spoken, as we will learn later on, it means total judgment. Well, having given you a concise overview of our passage of study, let's now dig deeper into it to discover the rich and relevant lessons the Holy Spirit is eager and enthused to impress upon our hearts to do his gracious and glorious work of making you and making me, molding you and molding me into the glorious image of Jesus Christ, who is our love, our life, our lover, our Lord, and our leader in this life and in the life soon to come. So we begin first of all by examining his teaching. The desolation of Nineveh is prophesied in verse 10a. Speaking by the Holy Spirit, Nahum prophesies the desolation of Nineveh in a few but forceful, vivid words. He says what? The first part of verse 10, he says what? She's emptied. Yes, she's desolate and waste. Those words are forceful. This is also translated, she's pillaged, plundered, stripped. All this comes from three Hebrew words at the beginning of verse 10, having similar sounds. And I'll pronounce them as it reads in the Hebrew Bible. Verse 10a, three words in the Hebrew. Buka, umebuka, umebulaka. Buka, umebuka, umebulaka. These three Hebrew words are well-chosen synonyms which give much force to the concept of complete desolation and destruction and devastation of Nineveh. Actually, those three words, or these three Hebrew words, imitate the sound of emptying of a bottle. If you have a bottle full of water, try and empty that bottle. It will give you some sounds. It will sound like buka, umebuka, umebulaka. That's how it sounds. So it's a vivid picture. So the point being vividly made here is that all of the great amount of wealth and treasures Nineveh had accumulated for herself, nothing was left of all that but desolate emptiness. In other words, the expression she's emptied, desolate and waste is a description of Nineveh emptied of inhabitants due to their fleeing, slaughter, or captivity, and destroyed by the victorious invaders after they had finished their plundering of the city of Nineveh. You see, Assyria had brought in booty from everywhere else and had gathered it in, you know, it all in one place. But now the emptiness, the enemies came in and took it all out, leaving Nineveh desolated. Actually, the Babylonian chronicles confirm the fact that a great quantity of plunder was carried off by the invaders, leaving Nineveh not only desolate of people, but desolate of all its resources. This is how desolate Yahweh predicted Nineveh will be. Well, with the great city of Nineveh being stripped desolate and lying in ruins, one might ask the question, what is the emotional state of the Ninevites who are observing the desolation and destruction unfolding before their very eyes? What was their emotional state? Well, their emotional state is one of helplessness and hopelessness. As such, the despondency of the Ninevites is pictured for us in verse 10b. You see, the Assyrians, who previously had been proud of how they terrorized other nations and peoples, now experience extreme terror, dread, and despair. In short, they experience despondency of epic proportions. The question is, how does the Bible picture the despondency of the Ninevites who are beholding the desolation of their beloved city, the greatest city of the world at that time? Well, the Bible pictures the despondency in four vivid and visual ways. That is what the second part of verse 10 is all about. What does the Bible say in that verse, the second part? It says what? Hearts are melting and knees knocking. Also, anguish is in the whole body. And all faces, and all their faces are grown pale. That's the picture the Bible gives us regarding their emotional state. First, we find them with hearts that are melting. The Hebrew says, velev names. All courage is gone, and none has the heart to continue the struggle of fighting for the defense of their beloved city. The once proud, powerful, pompous, and presumptuous Ninevites become what? Helpless and hopeless with dread and despair. They had never experienced that in their history. They were the ones causing dread and despair among the nations wherever they went. They would capture, conquer, causing great dread in the lands where they went. But now their time had come. They were hopeless and helpless with dread and despair. That, I tell you, friends, is perfect despondency. Actually, the Hebrew word translated heart is love. It means the center or middle of something. Often the word means the physical heart, that is the blood pumping organ that you have and I have. However, it is more common to interpret the term as the totality of man's inner or immaterial nature. This usage has passed into common English with expressions which we all know about these expressions. For example, heart and soul. We talk about that, heart and soul. You put your heart and soul in it. The heart goes out to someone. One's heart is in one's mouth. His heart is in the right place. We tell people that. You have a heart of gold. Or we say, from the bottom of my heart. Or let's have a heart-to-heart talk. You see, these expressions are ways of communicating our deepest feelings. When I want to tell someone, let's have a heart-to-heart talk, I'm not talking about fluffy stuff. And you are not talking about fluffy stuff. You're not talking about something superficial. You're talking about something deep on your heart, within you. So to say that hearts are melting is to reveal the deepest emotional feeling of the Ninevites. And what was that? It was one of despondency, despair, and dejection. Well, second, the Bible tells us their knees are knocking. In that despondent state, the Bible pictures for us Ninevites whose knees are trembling or giving way. Actually, the Hebrew word translated knocking is pick. It means a tottering or a smiting together. It occurs only in Nahum chapter 2, verse 10. You never find the Bible saying some people's knees are knocking anywhere else. There is only one place in the Bible it says people's knees are knocking, and that is in Nahum chapter 2, verse 10. So the question is, when your knees are knocking, what does it actually mean for you emotionally or mentally? When your knees are knocking or giving way, it means that you are what? You are afraid. Yeah, exactly. It means that there is fear in your heart, so that you can hardly keep on your feet. If your heart is pounding with fear, you just can't stay on your feet. Well, this is what happened to the Assyrians in their despondency. But that's not all. Third, the Bible tells us also anguish is in the whole body, from top to bottom. If you can imagine that, anguish being in the whole body from top to bottom. Well, literally that expression means and labor, pain in all loins. Here the Bible compares the anguish or their pain to the labor pains of women in childbirth. Those of you who have had children as women know how that experience is. And the Bible says anguish is in the whole body. All courage is gone, but anguish takes its place. So on one hand, their courage has vanished, and you think that they will just be neutral. But no, anguish, pain took over. Such is the despondency of the Ninevites. But that's not all. For the Bible tells us, we are told, all their faces are grown pale. In other words, the countenance of every Ninevite dramatically changed as they behold their city being destroyed and desolated. Once they could have go about with proud look, but now their faces have grown pale. Stark terror is written on every face. This was a time of great fear and dread for the Ninevites. What a sad picture this is of the once magnificent leader among the nations. Please listen carefully to me. All power, such as Assyria had, is but for a moment when it is pitted against the omnipotent God of the universe. What gloom and despair came upon the Ninevites? What makes it worse is this, that the Ninevites never made it out of their despondency. They perished in that state of despondency. Remember the story of Helen Madison? She was despondent for many years, but she didn't die in that state of despondency. She found hope and peace in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. But not so for the Ninevites. They perish in their state of despondency. Well, today we have terrorist groups who are terrorizing nations and communities of the world, killing, slaughtering, blowing up people as they blow up themselves. Well, like the Ninevites, they are causing what? Fear, dread, and despair among many today in the nations. But may I say to us, Yahweh's time will come for them, and they too will be in great dread and despair and perish in their despondency. Well, in the first part of verse 10, we learn that the desolation of Nineveh is prophesied. That was what we saw. In the second part of verse 10, the Bible also taught us that the despondency of Nineveh is pictured. Now in verses 11 to 12, we will find out the devastation of Nineveh is portrayed for us. In verses 11 to 12, the prophet Nahum, seeing the devastation of Nineveh in spirit as having already taken place, looks around for the site on which the mighty and magnificent city once stood, and sees it no more. It's gone. In other words, he beholds in the spirit of God that the destruction of Nineveh is already accomplished, and asks the taunting questions of the city, which has boasted so much in her time. You see, in pride, they ask, where are the gods of Hamath? In 2 Kings chapter 18, I like this because it gives us a glimpse of how the Assyrians were so proud in conquering nations. Listen to what one of their spokesmen said as they speak and threaten the people of Judah. The Bible says in verse 33 of 2 Kings chapter 18, has any of the gods of the nations delivered his land from the hand of the king of Assyria? Where are the gods of Hamath and Arpad? Where are the gods of Sepharvaim, Hena, and Eva? Have they delivered Samaria from my hand? Who among all the gods of the lands have delivered their land from my hand, that the Lord should deliver Jerusalem from my hand? This is the proud boasting of Assyria. But now you know what? Now it is Yahweh's turn to ask them the same questions. And so that is what we see in verse 11 and 12. I like 11 and 12. It says, where is the den of the lions and the feeding place of the young lions? Where the lion, lioness, and lion's cub prowled with nothing to disturb them? The lion tore enough for his cubs, killed enough for his lionesses, and filled his lairs with prey, and his dens with torn flesh. Notice the Bible describes Nineveh as the dwelling place or the den of lions, symbolizing her pride, her power, and her fearlessness. The figure of lions vividly brings out the ravenous lust and ferocious strength of Nineveh's rulers and warriors who crushed the nations like lions, plundering and pillaging their treasures and bringing them into Nineveh. The symbol is made full and forceful by the mention of the lion, the young lion, the lioness, and the lion's cub or whelp. Actually, the lion as king of the beast is a very fitting emblem for the kings of or rulers of Assyria. And the lionesses and the young lions are the people of Nineveh. We'll see that later as the Bible says, a sword will devour your young lions, referring to the people of Nineveh. Actually, Nahum used the words lions, lion, lionesses, and young lions and lion's cub 7 times in 2 verses to make the symbol of the lion full and forceful. Actually, the figure is reinforced by virtue of the frequent identification of the Lord with the power of lion. The Lord also is referred to as lion. He is the lion of Judah, and his power is great. But here the Bible is using that figure to refer to Nineveh, how it was powerful and dominated the nations of their time. Now the question in verse 11 can be summed up as follows. It says, where is the dwelling place, which was also a feeding place of young lions? Or to ask it more plainly, where is the city now in which the Assyrians swept together the booty of the nations and the kingdoms which they had destroyed? That's the question the prophet is tauntingly asking in the spirit. Well, the answer to that question is what? That city is no more. That empire is no more. like a pride of lions with plenty to eat and in fear of no enemy, Nineveh ruthlessly tore in pieces her prey. But she herself, the Bible now says, become what? Prey for other nations under the direction of Yahweh and be no more. Actually, the comparison of Nineveh to a lion's den is especially fitting because lions of every form with wings and at times with a man's head are found frequently in the Assyrian sculptures. If you have a Bible dictionary, you see that for yourself. You see, when it talks about Assyria, they have a picture of a lion with wings and sometimes with a man's head, symbolizing their power. Just like the United States have the eagle, the Ninevites had the lion. You see, during the time of Assyrian might, no other nation dared to or could attack Nineveh. No one was found to disturb them or terrify them or cause them to be afraid or anxious or frighten them at all. They enjoyed what? Perfect rest and security. Being undisturbed, the Assyrian lion tore in pieces, strangled and filled his caves and dens with prey. The Assyrian relics bear eloquent witness to this description of the rapacious and ravenous ways of the Assyrian kings. In fact, Tiglath-Pileser I boasted, who's one of the kings of Assyria, and you can find that also in 2 Kings and 2 Chronicles, that he had fought and conquered 60 kings. In the beginning of his reign, in combat with 5 kings, he made the blood of the warriors to flow in the valleys and on the high places of the mountains. He cut off the heads of his enemies and piled them up outside their cities like heaps of grain. City after city is reported as having been defeated, burned with fire, devastated and destroyed. 25 cities of one land were so treated in one campaign. Their troops were cut down like lambs. One boast of this king, that is Tiglath-Pileser I, was that he dyed a mountain red with the blood of the slain. The mountains behind me were tied with the blood of the stain. I tell you, friends, such was the ravenous lust and ferocious strength of the Assyrian lion. The prediction of the prophet of God has been fulfilled so literally that armies have marched over the city of Nineveh without knowing they were passing over its ruins. Bible teacher Pastor James Boyce shares this helpful insight. Quote, "The agreement between Nahum's prophecy and the details of Nineveh's fall are so great that some commentators have declared it a vaticinium ex eventu, that is Latin for a prophecy made after the event. But Nahum did not write after Nineveh's fall. He wrote at the height of her power, that a Judean author writing at a time when the invisible armies of Assyria were running unchecked across Asia, plundering all in their path, should predict the sudden destruction of the Assyrian capital and do so in such minute detail is surely another evidence of the divine origin of the Word of God," unquote. Well, now please understand that God had given the people of Nineveh a chance to repent, which he did after hearing a personal messenger, from God, that is Jonah. But they had returned to their old sinful ways and rejected the light God had given them. God waited patiently for them to turn back to Him. But you see, friends, there is a point for people, cities, and nations after which there is no turning back. Assyria had passed that point. That is why we have this story of judgment. As such, the judgment of Yahweh is bound to come upon them soon. And my prayer is that we will not cross that line of no return. Because once we cross that line of no return, there's only one thing left, judgment. Well, that is why the declaration of Yahweh against Nineveh is now presented to us in verse 13. Please listen, the destruction of Nineveh will assuredly take place because Yahweh himself has declared it, and he will also do as he has declared. In other words, Yahweh declares what is sure to happen. That is the difference between God, the true God of the Bible, and all other gods. What he declares is sure to happen. None of the gods have that record or reputation. Notice what the Bible says in verse 13. Behold, I am against you, declares the Lord of hosts. I will burn up her chariots in smoke. A sword will devour your young lions. I will cut off your prey from the land, and no longer will the voice of your messengers be heard. Nineveh will fall, because this is the will of Yahweh himself. In a dramatic manner, the Bible confidently and convincingly tells us that Yahweh's declaration against Nineveh is sure to happen. And that is why he says, behold, I am against you, declares the Lord of hosts. The verb translated declares sounds like Nahum. It's Nahum. It was used especially of the voice of Yahweh, by which oracles were received by or revealed to prophets. Characteristically, it ended God's message. Sometimes when you read that expression, declares the Lord or declares the Lord of hosts, it's at the end of the statement. Occasionally, it appeared in the middle of the message, as in the case in verse 13, when it says, behold, I am against you, declares the Lord. It was in the middle of the sentence, and then he added more. Now please notice the description of God in this verse. He is described for the first time in the prophecy of Nahum as the Lord of hosts. If you have the NIV, it says the Lord Almighty. The Hebrew says simply Yahweh Tzevaot. So the question is, what does this name reveal of God? Because the Bible, for names, the names of people in the Bible have great meaning, more so the names of God. So what does the name of God as Yahweh Tzevaot, the Lord of hosts, reveal of him? Well, it is a divine title and a special name for God. This divine title or special name for God depicts Yahweh as the mightiest warrior or all-powerful king of Israel who sovereignly rules and reigns over the entire universe. It first appears in 1 Samuel chapter 1 verse 3 as a title by which God was worshipped at Shiloh. It is common in the prophets and is used to exhibit Yahweh at all times as the savior and protector of his believing people. And the hosts that are around are all the heavenly powers ready to do the Lord's command. So now please notice that the declaration of Yahweh against Nineveh spells out his dreadful judgment about to be unleashed on Nineveh. Using the language of certainty, Yahweh Tzevaot spells confidently, spells out four dreadful divine acts of judgment upon Nineveh. First is what? First, he says her chariots will be burnt up in smoke. You see, Nineveh's fall will not be caused by merely natural forces or the superior power of her attackers. It will be an act of Yahweh himself. That is why the Bible says, I will burn Yahweh, I, Yahweh Tzebaoth, will burn up his chariots in smoke. You see, the Assyrians rely fully on their chariots in their warfare. Just like we rely on our drones, all our military gadgets and equipment for war. For the Assyrians, the chariots were the most powerful weapons of war. But now Yahweh says he will burn them all up. He will destroy her war chariots, which represent their whole military prowess. But second, Nineveh's choice warriors and citizens will come under dreadful divine judgment. That is why the Bible says a sword will devour your young lions. In other words, her own people will now be decimated. The sword will now bereave her followers as she had done on countless occasions to other peoples. Third, the judgment of God will be the cessation of carrying off the spoils of the nations. You see, a major source of the wealth of Assyria and the economy came from what? From plunder. They didn't manufacture goods. They just go and kill people and bring in wealth, left and right. They maintain their extravagant lifestyle by depriving others of what they own. That is why Yahweh Tzebaoth convincingly declares, I will cut off your prey from the land. Nineveh will no more carry off the spoils of the nations of the earth. That practice, God says, will cease and come to a screeching halt. Her enviable position among the nations of the world will be a thing of the past. And then fourth, the Bible says the carriers of the Assyrian king's commands to the nations they've conquered or intend to conquer will be silenced for good. That is why the Bible says, no longer will the voice of your messengers be heard. Her messengers carrying the commands of the conquering Assyrian monarch and demanding tribute of vassal nations will be silenced for good, to vex the oppressed people no more. The voice of the royal emissaries, like the Rav Sheke, who we just read some of his statements in 2 Kings chapter 18, that voice will no longer be there to threaten other nations. This is truly a dreadful judgment upon Nineveh, but it was occasioned by the fullness of the cup of her iniquity. Nineveh had been put on trial and found what? Guilty. And sentenced to destruction. Whereas Nineveh had been the hub of the world with its envoys scampering off in all directions, now all that is over. You ask, why did Nineveh experience all these dreadful divine acts of judgment? Well, the answer is given by Yahweh himself when he says, I am against you. I tell you, friends, these are fearful and frightening words when uttered by the living God against those who have incurred his righteous indignation. You see, Yahweh entrusted Nineveh with what? A large measure of sovereignty over the people of her day. Instead of ruling in the fear of Yahweh, Nineveh employed her power, her influence to destroy and dominate nations, to capture and conquer kingdoms, to to plunder and pillage them for what? For her own profit. It wasn't for the profit of other nations. It's all for her own profit. You see, Nineveh failed to abide by the divine principle that to whom much is given, much is expected. So think about that, because that is the question I'll ask you when I shake your hands after this message. Much has been given to you. Much is expected of you and of me. The Assyrians had had light, but they rejected it. And when you reject the light of God, your responsibility becomes greater. With this, Yahweh declares Nineveh's iniquity is full, and it is time for judgment. In Romans chapter 8, verse 31, the Bible tells us that if God be for us, who can be against us? It's a great promise for believers in Jesus Christ. No one, absolutely no one, can successfully be against us when God is for us. But friends, do you know that the reverse is true also? That is, if God be against an individual or nation by virtue of sin, then no one can successfully be for that person or nation. This is where the Ninevites found themselves. Yahweh is against them. Actually, the expression, "Behold, I'm against you," is also frequently found in the prophecies of Jeremiah and Ezekiel, which I don't have time to refer to. But please listen, the point I want to make here is that whenever Yahweh uses this expression, it means total judgment upon those on whom it is pronounced. Yahweh says to Nineveh, "I am against you. I'm going to bring you down. I will annihilate you, and you never appear again." And that is exactly what happened. Commenting on the words, "Behold, I am against you," Bible teacher James Boyce again shares this practical and poignant insight. And I quote him. And I want you to listen carefully as I bring this message to a close. "This is a dreadful thing. It is terrible to have the great God of the universe say, 'I am against you.' But it is not only to Nineveh that he speaks these words. He speaks them to all who sin against him, whether in Nineveh, Rome, New York, Philadelphia, or wherever the sinner may be. If God says to you that to you, you should know that it is a terrible thing to fall into the hands of such an angry God. These judgments, recorded so vividly in the pages of the Word of God, are not given to titillate our minds by comparing them with the eventual fulfillment in history. God records these judgments to show us that he is a God of judgment as well as a God of love, and that judgment upon the wicked will surely come. The judge of all the earth does right. What is right where you are concerned? If you have your way, spurned God's law, sought up your own corrupt devices, justice demands your eternal condemnation. God must and will judge you. In terms of that great judgment, which is hell, the fall of Nineveh is almost insignificant. Yet God tells you this so you might turn from your sin and seek his face at the cross of his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Deliverance is to be found at this cross because God poured out his judgment there. The cross is your shelter, if you will have it so. It is only as we stand beneath it that we are protected from the greatest of all judgments, which is yet to come." Unquote. Please, if you are not a believer in the Lord Jesus, I will humbly implore you at this special time to turn simply to Jesus just as you are and tell Jesus that you are a sinner seeking his face at the cross. And then trust Jesus with simple, sincere, childlike faith that he died on that cross 2,000 years ago for your sins, and that he was buried to put away your sins, and that he rose on the third day to bring you into a right standing with a holy God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we commit this message to you. We thank you for the warning that you have given to us today as a people of God and as a nation. Lord, I do pray for this nation that you will continue to direct our hearts to you, that we will not be like Nineveh, turning and turning away from you until we cross the line and judgment comes upon us. Now, Lord, I pronounce your blessing upon your people. Grace be with you all. And all God's people said, Amen.